प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर पूर्वी पोखरियाल, प्रोफेसर तारकेश मेधा, माय डिस्टिंग्विश्ड कलीग्स हियर, मिस्टर केटीएस तुलसी, शुद्धिशन दवे एंड आई फाइंड सम मोर कलीग्स इन फ्रंट ऑफ मी, सार विकटरमणी, मिस पल्लवी सुराव, पल्लवी गंसाल्विस एंड the distinguished members present here who are associated with the management of this beautiful university with an excellent campus and very peaceful environment, and my young friends, the law students of today are the leaders of tomorrow. I congratulate you for choosing law as your career. I'll congratulate those who have decided to join the bar or make a career in the judiciary or take to legal research or teaching. According to me, there are three preferred areas which gives you tremendous job satisfaction if you have the aptitude for it. I don't mean any disrespect to the corporate sector, who can lure you away with very attractive packages and other incentives. Pallavi is here to pick with the best available talent in all the law schools. But if you want to have more than a lucrative start, something more enduring, more satisfactory, which can give you glittering success, that is, according to me, in these three areas. As a judicial career is one of the excellent careers you can think of. You can join immediately after your degree. Now it is possible, or as soon as you can, where you can shape the law for the country and also have sense of doing justice. The judicial function is a divine function. We address them as my lords in the constitutional courts, and our petitions end with a prayer that your lords may be pleased to grant this, 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 this. That's what we do when you enter a temple or a mosque or a church. We have your desires, your wishes, you place before the God and ask for this. That is one glorious career you can have. And what great satisfaction it is to be cited long after one is gone and gone, that so and so said like this in that such judgment. We remember Vivian Bose, a great judge, how crisply he used to put across his thoughts and propositions of law. Innovative he was. We remember the Siddhetullah, again, who blended law with literature, with profound knowledge which he had reflected in the judgments, with great clarity and independent thinking. As V.R. Krishnayar, the greatest judge of all times, who raised the stature of the court in the eyes of the world. So we have Justice Bhagavati, who molded the law in a creative manner towards its growth and development. How many judgments we have got? So that's one glorious career. As a lawyer, you can have, if you have the aptitude to enter parliament like Mr. Tulsi, you can have one leg in court, one leg in parliament. You can shape as a good politician, a political leader, and statesman. You remember all the leaders, prominent leaders in the freedom movement, were drawn from one profession. Next to that, perhaps, there were doctors, Dr. B.C. Roy and others, and there were professors. Look at the Constituent Assembly composition. What a galaxy of men drawn from different walks of life. But many prominent lawyers were there, who sacrificed their careers and entered the political field in those days in response to Mahatma Gandhi's call. Mahatma Gandhi was born in this great land, and he raised the level of political debate, and with innovative methods of satyagraha and ahimsa, he has given a lead for the entire world. Then you have legal research. Whom do you read in your books now? The concepts of law, jurisprudence, you say you go to Samand and then build up dais, this, that, various others who have come in. Constitutional law, you've got great authors. You start with Dicey's, Arrival Jennings and all that, and go on. So like that, if you shape yourself as good teachers and research scholars, you will be remembered by the works you produce. So that's another career you have. But I congratulate you for joining the law school here, and you have a very bright future, it is all in your hands. As I was mentioning to one of the students yesterday, Mount Everest is there to be scaled and conquered. Whether you would like to do that or not, it's in you. How much you would like to trek and go up, it is in your hands. Now coming to the next thing, just a passing thought, as my distinguished colleague, Mr. K.V.S. Tulsi was propounding the subject of Uniform Civil Code, one passing thought. There is practical difficulties in evolving a uniform civil code of the country. You remember when Shaban case came about the maintenance of a Muslim widow, right to maintenance under the Criminal Procedure Code, which rightly said is secular law. What resistance was there? The government of the day, led by a very good Prime Minister, well-meaning, well-intended Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi, was coerced into bringing out a law to take to rob the effect of the judgment. But thanks to the Supreme Court, here comes the importance of judiciary. The same law is interpreted in favor of women and made it more effective and solid. That is what happens in the judiciary. Law wanted to take away the effect of the judgment. The Supreme Court, interpreting the same law in a different way, the right of women to get maintenance, a divorced woman, they said it is not limited to the period of iddat, which Mr. Tulsi has referred to as waiting period after divorce. It is during that period you must make provision, but provision must be for life long. That's how the judiciary takes the law forward. Now, how to achieve it, according to me? If you go straight away to Uniform Civil Code, immediately you will find all people in different quarters raising hue and cry. There's another safer route, a possible route, a feasible route, which you can take. You can achieve it in stages. If you look at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, there is a human right mentioned there. We are mentioning it, India is a party to that. So you have a duty to enforce the treaties and obligations which you have undertaken on the international arena. Being a party to the Human Declaration of Human Rights, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was proper 1949, we have to implement them. If you are implementing a human right, nobody can take objection. One human right says, men and women shall have equal right to enter into marriage, during marriage, and at the dissolution of marriage. Just take care of these three aspects. Right to enter into a marriage, equal right. During the marriage, equal right. And at dissolution, equal right. You can take the bulk of the grievance of women outside the purview of personal law and making it an equal rights to men and women act in marriage. Some such act, you can have it. Just have Equal Remuneration Act now. That may be a safer route, according to me. Now coming to the topic, as students of law and as students of constitutional law, naturally you would like to know what the Constitution is about, how it has been interpreted, and what it aims at, and what's the present state of affairs in regard to the various provisions and the various basic features of the Constitution, all that. That's one part. But you are duty to the country as students of constitutional law, not only read it, but work for the aims and objects of the Constitution. All of us as citizens have a duty to work for the aims and objects of the Constitution. In whatever role fate has ordained to you, whatever be you are, be conscious of the fact there is a constitutional agenda which is unfinished which I'm sorry to say, present day political leaders are not paying attention to. The kind of attention, the votes, how to get votes receives, even a fraction of it is not paid to the constitutional objectives. I'm going to touch upon a topic which is, certain aspects of the topic are very controversial, but I would like to place my viewpoint on those aspects. The best part of the Constitution, according to me, is not in the text. It is before the text, the preamble. Preamble. Amble is to walk, to move. Preamble is before, pre. That is, walks before the Constitution. That pithily sets out the solemn resolve of the people of India to constitute India into a sovereign democratic, etc. Socialist also added, secular added. Then it says, what is the object is to secure to all citizens justice, liberty, equality of status and opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. If this you are able to achieve, the country will move very fast forward, it will move forward very fast. But where are we? Are we doing anything to achieve this? Are we uniting people or are we dividing people? This is the topic which I wanted to discuss with you today. And this preamble finds its reflection, concretization of the ideas in the body of the Constitution. The right to equality, equal to state of an opportunity is the promise of the preamble. In the body you have right, Article 14, which Ms. Katie Stoll says, just to mention, right to equality. It is on that basis that he projected his viewpoint on UCC. Then you have Article 15.2, which prohibits discrimination only on the ground of various things, including religion, race, caste. I am confining to these aspects. Religion, race, caste, no discrimination in the matter of access to public places. Then you have Article 16.2, which again in the matter of public employment, see, there is no discrimination only on the grounds of inter alia, religion, race, caste, etc. So you cannot have a discrimination on the basis of caste. Then they want other provisions which permit special provisions for in favor of backward classes, scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, in the matter of education. That is Article 15.4, again 15.5 has provided for special provisions in the matter of admission to education institutions, including private institutions, except minority institutions. So that is a special provision which enables them to help the backward classes, scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. All well-intentioned provisions. Then in the matter of public employment, Article 16.4, which provides for reservation of jobs and posts in public employment for the benefit of backward classes. That term has been interpreted, as you all know, to include scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, because they are the most backward among the backward classes and other backward classes. These are reservations which have been provided for. But in the matter of education, there are further obligations cast on the state. Education is the basis, enabling factor for availing opportunities of employment. If you don't have education, prospects of employment are bleak. So what does the Constitution say? Constitution provided among the directive principles. One directive principle which indicated you must try to endeavor to achieve this within 10 years, indicating the urgency of the thing, issue, and the time, and that is to impart free and compulsory education to every child in the country until the child attains the age of 14 years. Imagine the importance attached to this particular provision by the Constitution makers. Why they say 10 years? Because mass of citizens illiterate at the time when the Constitution was made. India attained independence. Illiterate, poor country it was. And they had given most valuable right adult franchise, universal adult franchise, they incorporate the constitution, the right to vote, to choose the representatives who should govern themselves. That is the mechanism of self-governance. So this mandate was given. If only this had been fulfilled, today there would have been no need for any reservations. It was not done. 10 years gone, multiples of 10 years gone, nobody has done it. Ultimately what happened? The Supreme Court in the year 1993 declared education up to the age of 14 years is a fundamental right, part of right to life. Because right to life means right to life with dignity. With education you can't have dignity. Therefore they said, we declare this to be part of Article 51. After the declaration also, things did not move. That was in 1993. Ultimately, in 2002, Article 21A was brought into the Part 3 of the Constitution, which provides for right to free and compulsory education for children up to the age group of 6 years. Then you have Article 41, which speaks of right to work and right to education, which is to provide it. We don't have it as of now. And there's no indication when it will be. The most important article in the Dietary Principles Set Policy is, so far as vehicle sections are concerned, it is not the reservation provisions in Part 3. In Part 4, the positive mandate is Article 46. It directs the state to promote with special care the educational and economic interests of scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other vehicle sections. This is where the country has failed. We have not promoted special care beyond reservations. Nothing is done. Whereas this is the positive thing to be done, to equip them, to get level playing field for them and others, backwards and non-backwards, to compete with confidence in terms of equality. This has not been done even today. Unless you do this, backwardness cannot go. Educational backwardness and backward equal opportunity employment, you cannot secure. Having said this, I would like to turn to another aspect. Reservations were conceived as a temporary measure, as a transitory measure, till the state brings up the vehicle sections by promoting the educational interests and economic interests. Now I come to the second aspect of it, whether caste-based reservations are compatible with the secular constitution and the right to equality which prohibits discrimination on the basis of caste. Here I would like to quote what Dr. Ambedkar, one of the greatest leaders who contributed to the shaping of the constitution as chairman of the drafting committee. He said in the Constitutional Assembly, he said, liberty, equality and fraternity form a union of trinity. He said, fraternity means a sense of common brotherhood of all Indians. If Indians being one people, it is the principle which gives unity and solidarity to social life. It's a difficult thing to achieve. Then he continued to say, in India there are castes. The castes are anti-national. He further goes on saying that they generate jealousy and antipathy between caste and caste, and they bring about separation in social life. But our political leaders, without exception, cling on to caste-based reservations. When V.P. Singh was the Prime Minister, he introduced Mandal Commission report, gave effect to it by providing for caste-based reservation. What is the response of the Supreme Court to caste-based reservations? Indira Sani. Some of us fought against caste being made the basis of identification of backward classes. I said, for God's sake, don't do it. This is against the ethos of secularism. The Constitution postulates a casteless society, a classless society. Whereas this recognition of caste as the basis of identification of backward classes perpetuates caste system, which is not in the interest of the country. Two judges, they were clear about it, they accepted it, Kuldeep Singh and Justice R.M. Sahai. Majority of the judges they couldn't get out of the influence of caste. And ultimately what they said was, yes, earlier Supreme Court has upheld a 5-judge bench reservation in favor of backward classes without reference to caste. That can be done. Caste is not the only basis for making reservations, but it could also be a basis. So they gave option. In fact, this Jeevan Reddy, whose judgment is considered as the majority voice, actually it is representing only 4 judges, but on various aspects others have agreed. He said there could be identification without reference to caste. For instance, agriculture laborers, rickshaw pullers, drivers, street hawkers, all these would qualify to be treated as backward classes. But they did not ask the question, further question, if both are methods of identification which is consistent with the scheme of the Constitution, with the aim of the Constitution of bringing about a casteless society. That question they did not address. Had they addressed that question, the result would have been, perhaps, they had no option but to say it is the basis which doesn't refer to caste that's more consistent with the constitutional aim, not others. Then thereafter, see, we had this spectacle all over the country. Although 2 routes are mentioned for identification, in Gujarat, I must mention just the C.V. Rane Commission identified backward classes without reference to caste. But I don't think that was acted upon and implemented. Now, what do you do about this? One Supreme Court has blessed the caste reservations, where do we go? And you know the reaction of Nani Palkiwala to the judgment, Indira Sari's judgment. He said, the basic structure of the Constitution envisages a cohesive, unified, casteless society. By breathing new life into casteism, the judgment fractures the nation and disregards the basic structure of the Constitution. The decision would revitalize casteism, cleave the nation into 2, forward and backward, and open up new vistas for internecine conflicts and fissiparous forces, and make backwardness a vested interest. It will undo whatever has been achieved since independence towards creating a unified, integrated nation. The majority judgments will revive casteism, which the Constitution emphatically intended to end, and the pre-independence tragedy would be reenacted, and the roles reversed. Those who were underprivileged would now become the privileged. This was his justice of Mr. Palkiwala, a great jurist whose heart bled for the nation. You must read his speeches. They are all available now. We the nation, we the people, and also the speeches of Dr. Palkiwala, again codified, Dr. Singhvi and others, printed literature available. You must read it. It will open your mind to various aspects of constitutional law. He quoted Jawaharlal Nehru. Prime Minister Nehru said, he said that the only real way to help a backward group is to give opportunities for good education. If we go in for reservation and communal and caste basis, we swamp the bright and able people and remain second rate and third rate. It has amazed me to learn that even promotions are based sometimes on communal and caste considerations. This way lies not folly but disaster. These were his words. Lala and Sinha was one of our great former attorney generals. He said, adverting the reservation issue, he said there are 3 sets of components which you have to consider. One is the need of backward classes to move forward, help them to move forward. Second is the concerns of non-forward classes who will suffer as a result of it, deprivation of equal opportunity. But it is not these two alone. The largest component is the society at the community at large, which pays for the services. Employment, if you are offering employment to less meritorious but a backward citizen, who is paying for this employment? For all employment, the payer is the common man. They want best of services. So kindly keep them also into consideration. That's what he said. And he also said, in the long term, this will separate people instead of uniting them, not good for the country. That is solidarity. What is the ground reality? Professor Andrew Bettel is a professor of sociology of Delhi University. He has retired now. And Professor Shivaramaya, professor of law, they made special studies on the impact of reservations. They came to the conclusion, reservations can never remove backwardness. They cannot. They have only symbolic value. Yes, some people from the backward classes, some of them are coming. And if you go to see who are the beneficiaries of these backward classes, reservations, for calculating the percentage of reservations, you take the entire mass of backward classes together, or scheduled class together, scheduled tribes together. But among them, who are those who are able to avail the reservations? For that, you must understand at what level reservation is provided. For government jobs, or public sector jobs, public employment. And professional colleges, engineering, medicine, etc. Now, who are the persons who are eligible to avail the reservation? Only those who have at least 10+2 qualification. That is, among the scheduled castes, scheduled tribes and backward classes, the forward sections, they can avail these reservations made for backward classes. But what about the masses who don't have education, who don't have the ability, eligibility to even to apply for these posts or for admission to the colleges? What do they get out of it? You take them into consideration, make reservation percentages and give them. Ultimately, the beneficiaries are those who are forward among them, who are well-to-do among them, but the poorest among them remain poorest. There have been communities among scheduled castes where an entire caste did not produce a single graduate so far. Therefore, where are we going? And what is the ground reality? The forward castes want to get into backward class lists. Already many of them have managed to get into backward class lists. At the, Jats in Haryana, they were never regarded as backward by anybody. And they managed to get into backward class list. Supreme Court struck it down. Again, they are in the streets demanding inclusion reservation. And Gujarat, Patels want reservation. Andhra Pradesh, Kapus want reservation as backward classes. See the mindset which has been created by our political leaders. Now, instead of demanding their right to equality and equal opportunity and equal status, the poor people are content with demanding inclusion into the backward classes. Reservations. Reservation can never wipe out backwardness. They don't realize that. The right is to demand equality of status, equal opportunity employment. That is, give us the equipment, give us education, give us all props necessary for attaining education. This they are not demanding. Their minds are completely blinkered. Now they only think of reservation. So this is where I want to point out. Salvation doesn't lie in reservation. It can never solve the problems, it creates problems. So therefore we have to get out of this. That is one aspect. Second thing I want to mention is this. Reservations are not limited to employment and education, professional education. It also goes into elected representatives at various levels. In Lok Sabha, also the people in parliament, in assemblies, there is a provision for reservation for scheduled castes, scheduled tribes. The constitution makers initially thought for 10 years we must give them this benefit so that they will be able to come in, otherwise they will not be able to come in. The 10 years mechanically extended every 10 years. For another 10 years, another 10 years, another 10 years. Now it stands extended for 10 years more. This is under challenge in the Supreme Court. I want to bring to your notice. And one of the petitioners thought of engaging me. It will be for a constitutional bench, we are going to argue that. The post of President of India is not reserved. We have had a scheduled caste president. Post of Chief Justice of India is not reserved. We had a Chief Justice who came from scheduled caste. judges of scheduled caste. The speaker's post is not reserved. Where is scheduled tribe speaker Sangma? These are undeserved posts. Therefore, if they are able to come up to this level, is it necessary to provide for reservation assemblies and parliament even today? In a democracy, what happens? Numbers matter. So long as scheduled caste population is sizable, they are bound to be re-elected. Why do you need a reservation? Why this separation? Why is vested interest in being in a caste, belonging to a scheduled caste, a scheduled tribe, or this one? When are we going to mix up all these into one particular common Indian citizens? That's why Ambedkar said, casteism supposed to be based on division of labor. But it has become division of laborers. Separation has come. So friends, the issue is a very serious one. All of you have to think of it. When are you going to achieve brotherhood, common brothers, fraternity? When are you going to promote, which is the object of the Constitution says, ultimately to promote among all fraternity, assuring the dignity of individual and unique integrity of the nation. These are paramount. Thank you very much.